Good morning, sojourners. Welcome to this, the 18th Sunday after Pentecost. And this Sunday, when we also observe World Communion Sunday. We welcome you to this Sojourners live stream service of worship. We trust that you will find this service inspiring and meaningful in every way. And I want to begin today with a comment that I want to make early in this service, and then we will move on with our celebration. There's a passage in Matthew's, in the fifth chapter of Matthew, verses 44 and part of verse 45. But I say, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you. In that way, you will be acting as children of your Creator in heaven. For God gives God's sunlight to both the evil and the good. It is because of passages like that one that we ask you to pray for the President of the United States and pray for members of his cabinet and members of the Senate and all others. Pray for the people of the United States who have lost relatives, so many relatives. Families have been impacted, not only in the US, but all around the world. Let us pray for all of them. In doing so, we are doing what is consistent with the word of the living God. Sharing in today's service of worship are Lance Allen, who's serving as our liturgist. The time with children will be provided by Villette Griffin and Kathy Dobie. Ian Little is with us to help with technology. Steve Brinkley, we've already heard on piano and as vocalist, and Reverend Karen Mann also helping with the technology on this morning. And she will also provide and coordinate our joys and concerns. I now pass you off to Lance Allen, who will lead our call to worship.
Thank you, Pastor Morgan. Creator God, on this World Communion Sunday, we are gathered in our sheltering in places in hope.
With community and creation.
With neighbors near and far.
With those known and those who are new to us.
With Christians across geography and across time.
To gather in hope, let us worship.
Let us pray.
Holy and gracious God, let us be open to your presence among your people, those gathered for worship, and all of your people throughout all the world. May we receive you fully and respond to you with highest praise. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Now, this is the time for our collections cart, and this is the time that usually children collect donations for the food bank for the Blue Ridge Community Area Food Bank, and other organizations still need your donations, perhaps even more than previously now. And it might be easier to contribute electronically, and you can do so by clicking the link in your bulletin or visiting the Blue Ridge Area Food Bank online. And now I'm going to pass it off to Kathy Dobie and Villette Griffin for our time with children.
Hi, friends. Good morning. Today is our first Sunday fun following the worship service. So we invite all children and families to drop in for a picnic on the playground from 12 to 1:30. They'll be singing. Becky Garrity will be bringing some clay, and we'll be creating communion plates for each family to have at their homes. And you'll also get to pick up your take-home bags with materials for home. You know, on this World Communion Sunday, people all over the world celebrate communion. We are one big family. We may have skin of different colors, wear different clothes, speak different languages, do all sorts of different things. But today we are mindful that when we gather at the table, we celebrate with sisters and brothers around the world. All this may look a little different this year, as people might be doing it in their homes. People all over the globe, in tropical jungles, way up in the mountains, on the beach, will all join together in eating bread and drinking the cup to remember and honor Jesus. You know, I imagine, like me, you are missing seeing our children in worship at the playground, gathering food, maybe catching up with them at the fellowship time. And today we have a special treat. Villette Griffin will be reading a book about breads from all around the world in honor of World Communion Sunday. World Communion Sunday for me is that day where we are reminded to rediscover our connections with each other.
My name is Villette. I am 5, almost 6. And my birthday is in October 16, and I am, my birthday is in 14 days, and I am, and it's October 2nd when we're recording it, and I'm going to do bread. People eat bread all over the world. There are many kinds, many shapes, many sizes. Cinnamon bread, fat bread, round, flat bread. Bread with a hole. Crunchy bread, runsy bread, bread with sugar, blue egg. Pizza pretzel, still bread too. Bread on the table, bread on your head. But it's good for you. It helps you grow. It makes you strong. Making bread, shaping bread, baking bread. Toasting bread, cooking bread over fire. Fill up the basket after your market. Bread for sale! Baking bread together. Have a bite. Delicious!
Thank you so much for that, Villette and Kathy. That was adorable. I suddenly have the urge to buy some bread for sure. All right, we're going to go into our contemporary readings. Calvin Coolidge, 20th century. I sometimes wish that people would put a little more emphasis upon the observance of the law than they do upon its enforcement. And our scripture lesson for the day comes from Matthew 21, 33 through 46. And Jesus said, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he said to his agents, to the tenants, to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his agents and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent the other agents more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance.' So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do with those tenants? They said to him, 'He will put those wretches to a miserable death and leave the vineyard to the other tenants, who will give him the produce at the harvest time.' Jesus said to them, Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone'? This was God's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And now our sermon will be delivered by our interim pastor, Dr. Morgan.
As long as Villette is among us, my job might be in danger. She's a great reader. Thank you for that message, both you and Kathy. The title for today's message is Your role in God's vineyard. Your role in God's vineyard. A little more than 20 years ago, some clergy colleagues and I were blessed to receive a grant from the Lilly Foundation that included continuing education and extensive world travel. When each of us were invited to select a place to lead the group, a place where we would lead the group, I chose to take the group to South Africa, where we visited with Nelson Mandela's extended, his staff and his extended family, in Johannesburg. We visited the University of KwaZulu-Natal in Durban. And we visited several sites in and around Cape Town. While in Cape Town, we visited one of the very nice vineyards where some of the best wine made anywhere in the world is produced. A properly attended vineyard then, both then, now, and always, will require a great deal of work. Cultivated grapevines must be carefully pruned as the vines are trained to grow in a position that makes the grapes accessible to those who are gonna pick the grapes later on. Wild grapes, on the other hand, are very difficult to harvest. Pests like birds and even little jackrabbits in West Texas find the wild grapes to be tantalizing. They will interfere with those wild grapes and do a great deal of damage. These days, modern grape growers, modern vineyard keepers are able to invest in little neat plastic plant protectors. But even then, a vineyard demands extensive preparation and constant vigilance. Today's gospel tells a story of a very special place, a beautiful, well-cared for vineyard. Jesus's parable is of obvious importance because that same parable appears not only in Matthew, but also in the 12th chapter of the book of Mark, and in the 20th chapter of the book of Luke. It is a story of God's great love for us, but like many parables, it teaches a tough and complicated lesson. My tendency when viewing parables like this one is to think about it from the viewpoint of the various participants in the drama. The first person in this story is the owner of the vineyard. The vineyard owner is not only a mere title holder, but this vineyard owner created, developed the vineyard. The owner cleared away the stones, planted the vines. The owner built the hedge and the watchtower. The owner dug the wine press. There was nothing more to be done to establish this vineyard than what had already been done by the owner. Now, I will confess to you, I have never planted a perfect vineyard, but I have baked an almost perfect homemade grated sweet potato pudding. I washed those potatoes, I peeled those potatoes, I grated the potatoes, these are sweet potatoes, of course. I combined all of the necessary ingredients, mostly according to the recipe, although I added a little extra sugar. And everything was poured together, placed in a baking bowl, and placed in the oven. When I took my almost perfect sweet potato pudding out of the oven, it looked and smelled wonderful. I can recall hearing our adult children and grandchildren as they would enter the front door of the house for a holiday meal. They would say things like, "Oh, Dad or Pop Pop must be cooking because I can smell sweet potato pudding and potato pies." For at least several hours, I could revel in the honor given to me for having baked such wonderful desserts. Perhaps you've had similar moments of such satisfaction. I assume that the vineyard owner was pleased as well. But then, the vineyard owner turned that perfect vineyard over to a bunch of less than perfect tenants. In a similar way, I turned my perfect, what I thought was perfect, sweet potato puddings over to my spouse, my children, and grandchildren. We did not get far into one of those holiday meals before one of my daughters said, "Dad, this is good. But there's something that you left out that grandma always placed in her puddings. I don't know what it is, but there's something missing. Well, it was as if my ego had been crushed. I didn't let them know it. And so with a single sentence, my pudding was declared a poor substitute for the ones made by my mother. I tried giving one excuse after another, but as many as my pudding disappeared from the baking dish, I had to admit that my labor, like that of the vineyard owner, did not yield the fruits of endless praise that I had anticipated. When the owner is denied the fruit of the vineyard, we meet the second set of characters in the story. They're the owner's servants or agents. The agents are essentially messengers, and the message they bring is not well received. Those of us who've ever worked in a supervisory position can certainly identify with these poor agents. They have a big responsibility, but only a small amount of the authority. Therefore, being mid-level managers, they're asked to carry messages from the company owner, if you will, that can be quite difficult, and it can bring unanticipated consequences. The owner responds then by sending a person who does have authority, his own son. At this point, I would like to offer some sympathy to all of those persons who have ever had to respond to their parents who ask them to take care of a younger sibling. Let me say, a younger, disobedient, and often downright stubborn sibling. All of you older siblings have probably already realized that I'm talking about you and us. I feel for you, for every time you have been asked to accompany the younger sibling to the bathroom, and you know that their primary objective is to play in the fountain, in the washing bowl. And there are other times when you're asked to take care of the siblings by calling them in from the streets of the city. I can remember one time after another, Mom asking, "Marvin, go call your brothers and tell them it's dinner time." I would go out and say, "Boys, it's dinner time." They would absolutely ignore me. Then I would say, "Boys, Mama said it's dinner time." That added a little more authority to my words, and they would then come in for their evening meal. Well, being your sister or brother's keeper is not an easy job. And Roger Dangerfield, those who remember him, will tell you we get no respect for fulfilling that role. Finally, this brings us to the tenants, the wicked husbandmen, as they're called in some texts. I'd rather not identify with this group, but it's difficult to avoid. They decide that they were not getting what they wanted out of this arrangement. And so they took it upon themselves to rewrite the contract, let's say, or act as if the contract was written differently. You can call them greedy and lazy, or you can call them aggressive and efficient. And these days of so-called alternate facts, you have a choice. I have, on many occasions, however, left something undone with hopes that someone else would take care of it. There are dishes in the kitchen sink right now, and my grandson is not present to wash those dishes, as he did so very often when he was with me for the summer. And then there are the push carts at the supermarket that I have often left in a convenient location, because that was a day when I was really in a hurry and I simply thought I did not have time to place that push cart in its usual location. Now, I'd like to think that these are not terrible sins. If they are, I'm in big trouble. But they are a lot like what the tenants did. I have plenty of excuses for my behavior. Many will understand when I say I was in a hurry. Others will understand when I say I didn't have time, or my knees were bothering me, or it's not my job. I'm sure the tenants felt that they were doing all the maintenance in the vineyard, keeping up the vines. Why shouldn't they receive all of the rewards? Well, now that we've looked just for a moment at these characters, and we've looked at them from several different vantage points, it's time to state the obvious. The owner and creator of the vineyard is God, our creator. The agents are God's messengers or prophets. Talk about being without honor. And the son is Jesus, the Christ. You and I, sojourners, the listeners and readers of the text, are the tenants in the vineyard. This parable asks us to do something, just as it asks the leaders of Israel to do something, and that is to examine and evaluate ourselves. This is not easy, but it is a necessary step toward redemption. Pay attention to your priorities. Look at how you spend your time. Consider how you expend your resources. Stop right now and look around you, wherever you are. You, sojourners, and all the people of the world on this World Communion Sunday are in the vineyard. And God has chosen us to take care of the vineyard. Your vineyard may not have a single vine in it. It might have suffered because of earlier tenancies. Some pastors serve very well. Others may have disappointed us. But sojourners, the Sojourners Community of Faith is still God's creation. You are called by God to be her stewards. She trusts you, and God will sustain you. However, the way you respond in the vineyard, that is a decision you must make. In the name of the Creator, Christ, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us pray. Creator God, we lift up our siblings around the world. We have heard their cries for justice and peace as they face the challenges of human rights abuses, damage to creation, natural disasters, and COVID-19. We know there are many obstacles to addressing these challenges, but we also know that you are greater than these, and that your love for your people is deeper than we could ever imagine. Cover your people with your love, O God, that may we sense your presence as you walk with us each day. Guide us that we may also walk beside our local and global neighbors in prayer, partnership, and presence. May we listen to you and our partners in ministry as we consider what we might do to share in ministry with all people. Let us reflect for a moment upon the news of the world that may be troubling to us, and reflect for a moment upon the news of the world that may give us hope. Weave us together in hope, O God, that we may recognize that we are all part of your great tapestry. All of our threads are needed and necessary for your beautiful design. Strengthen us and nourish us for the journey as you strengthen and nourish others around the globe. Amen. Sojourners, we've come to the point of the celebration of Holy Communion. We trust that you've had an opportunity to gather elements in your homes, a piece of bread or a cracker perhaps, and a beverage to serve for this special time together. As grain that was scattered on the hillside was gathered and made into one loaf, we too, although scattered at tables in our own homes, are bound together around Christ's table and become one. As grapes grown in the field are gathered together and pressed into wine, so too are we drawn together and pressed by our times to share a common lot and are transformed into Christ's self-giving love for all. God be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Give thanks to God, blessed Trinity.
It is right to give God thanks and praise. Praise to you, divine creator. Thank you for the gift of life, the beauty of nature, and your steadfast loving kindness. Praise to you, divine redeemer. Thank you for showing our human existence from birth through death to everlasting life. You have shown us a way worth emulating, bringing healing and hope to most people needed in around the world. Praise to you, divine sustainer. Thank you for the vision to see beyond the immediate, the calm in the midst of storm, strength to build an ever-expanding community, and the courage to bring about any change necessary within our lives. Amen.
Jesus shared many meals with his friends during his ministry. But in an upstairs room, he would have his last meal with his disciples because one of his friends would betray him. Knowing his time had come, he took bread and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." Later, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them saying, after blessing it, he gave it to his disciples saying, "Drink this. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. When you eat this bread and drink this cup, we open our mouths to proclaim together, and we invite you to say after me, Christ has died.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Christ will come again.
Let us pray. Holy God, send your spirit upon these gifts of grain and grapes, that they might be for us the presence of the living Christ, and pour out your spirit upon us so we might be taken, blessed, broken, and distributed, so others might know the blessings of living in worldwide communion with you and one another. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, now and forever. Amen. Sojourners, eat this bread, for it is the body of Christ broken for thee. Drink this cup, for it is the blood of Christ shed for thee. May the presence of God, Christ and the Holy Spirit keep and preserve you to everlasting life. Amen. Let us pray. For the beauty of creation, the gift of life, and your presence with each of us, even though we are physically distanced, we give you thanks. Work through us so we might be channels of your mission in the whole world to build your community on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Sojourners, we've come to that important point in our service of worship where we invite you to present gifts for the support of the church. When resources are short, did Christ worry? No, Christ saw the gifts and Christ multiplied them. We have a chance to experience a similar miracle each time we give to the church. God will take what we have, whatever it may be, and God will do good things with our gifts. We invite you to visit the church's website where you may click on the donate or pledge links. There you may make your donations. Others of you may choose to mail your gifts into the church office. Either way, Sojourners appreciates the gifts you make, because that assures as much as anything a future viability for this wonderful congregation. We're going to simply imagine seeing you dash off or reaching up to push the right buttons on your computer so that your gifts are being made. And those that will not be made during this time together in worship, perhaps they will be made in the next several hours. Let us ask God's blessings upon our gifts. Bless the gifts, dear God, that they may strengthen the church as it seeks to serve your people at home and around the world. Amen. Sojourners, Karen Mann is now going to coordinate our joys and concerns.
Good morning, Sojourners. It's good to be with you this morning. As we enter our time of joys and concerns, I invite you to write your joy or concerns in the chat box on Zoom, or you can leave it in the comments section on Facebook. And please remember that Facebook is a public forum and your comments can be seen by anyone. And while we give you a chance to submit those prayer requests, ask Steve to play for us a little bit. Thank you, Steve. Your music is beautiful as always. And this morning, I think I have two helpers to help me light the candles as we hear your joys and concerns. So first, we have Pamela offers a joy to see Lance as liturgist. And Pamela, we say amen to that. And Lance, we thank you for being with us this morning. It's good to see your face. And Pamela also offers continued prayers for our country. Pamela, we pray with you. Allison Linney writes, I'm so happy new people joined us for youth group last month, and pray others will join us next Sunday at 12 p.m. Allison, we pray with you and say amen to that. And those are the only prayers I'm seeing at this time. Give it just a minute, there we go. Enid Krieger offers prayers for all who continue to be shut in during this pandemic, especially those who may be living with someone who may represent a threat to their safety. Enid, we pray with you. Kate Galloway offers thanks to Bethel Church, which has vowed to provide 14 pounds of food box to anyone who comes Saturday mornings for 2 years. Amen to that, Kate. And we give thanks for that as well. My candle lighters are lighting prayers for all of you who are keeping your prayers silent this morning. And know that we pray with you. Wait, we've got one more over here. Pamela, again, offers joy and appreciation for Steve's musical talent and generosity. Steve, Pamela, amen to that. And Steve, we thank you for your many weeks of virtual Zoom music. You have done a fabulous job for us during this time. Allison Linney, okay, that's enough campus kids. Allison Linney says, I especially appreciate the things I learned from our 6th through 12th graders during youth group. They often helps me understand things that confuse me. Amen, Allison. And now Pastor Morgan will ask you to pray for us before we have too much fire. Amen.
Very good. Thank you so much, Karen. I'd like to simply affirm all of those joys that were expressed, both for the beautiful music that is provided from week to week, for the gifts of all of you who share in our services of worship, to help make the technology run as it should, and even as we, from time to time, make little mistakes as we go along. Let us pray. Dear God, we have so much to give thanks for, even in the midst of difficulties, anxieties, and concerns, even in the midst of the wholesale bereavement associated with the COVID-19 virus. Dear God, are you seeking to speak to us in the events of recent days? If so, grant that we may listen, that all of us may listen, not in judgmental ways, but simply stop long enough to cease the many things that claim our attention so that we might hear your still small voice in the midst of all of the stuff, much of it political and social. Dear God, abide with people of faith. Abide with all humankind, for we are all part of that common tapestry. We know that if one person suffers, all suffer together. If one is able to rejoice, it is our hope and your hope that all may rejoice together. Bless the people of the world, that we may hear your messages to us. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. And now Steve Brinkley is going to lead us in our closing hymn prior to brief remarks and the benediction. very much, Steve. In addition to the message in the parable, I want to end today's service as we began it. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them that despitefully use you, that you may be the children of your Creator in heaven. We end with these lines, Sojourners, because we know what has occupied our minds in recent days and what has occupied, will occupy our minds in the next couple of weeks. Let us remember these words from Matthew, and may our response to the current events be distinguishable from the responses of those who go out and buy ammunition and weapons and celebrate as they are standing by. Let us now receive the benediction. May the blessing of God, the Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit go with you into the world. Amen.